Okay, good morning, friends. I think the need of the phacoemulsification machine is to remove the nucleus. Rest all other steps can be performed manually without the phacoemulsifier. And this is the one of the most crucial steps, and we try to make it as simplified as possible. And so there were many techniques described when we started doing phacoemulsification way back in 92-93, but they were not reproducible till the time the divide and conquer technique came, where we divided into four quadrants and we could take them out, and surgery started becoming more reproducible, more predictable. But the only disadvantage was that too much of phaco energy was taken to trench this, and these pieces, even one-fourth of the piece, was too large to be pulled out of the capsule excess margin. Many a times it may tear the capsule excess, particularly if you make a smaller excess. Then came the phaco chopping technique, whereby we used to put the chopper into the periphery and pull it over here. So the only, it was difficulty was there, because at that time we were not making any trench like what we do as a direct chop now. Direct chop has improved over a period of time because of the better choppers, and more importantly, a phaco machine where you can build up a vacuum of 400 plus 500, 600. At that time, the vacuum we could build up was maximum 250. After that, the chamber will collapse. So the direct chop was not so successful, and the pieces will get entangled with each other. Many times you'll see the lady players, they are entangled when you try to do the direct chop. So the best technique what I found was the stop and chop technique. Why the name was stop and chop? Because you start as a divide and conquer, make one trench, now stop as a divide and conquer procedure, go into the chop technique. That's where it derived its name, stop and chop. So it started as divide and conquer and went on to the chopping technique. So before I go on to this, we need to understand the nucleus anatomy. This is far more conical backwards. That means if your trench is flat like this, this portion will be not trenched and you will not be able to break it. So your trench has to be into the shape of the cone or deeper into the center as compared to the periphery. If you see now, what I'm going to describe is a special type of a trenching technique, what I call as a V-trench. When I make first trench in the center, it keeps on slipping. I am not able to widen it so well. So instead of making first trench in the center, I make a trench which goes slightly off center onto the one side. Then I make another trench so that this is like in this animation, you can see like in a shape of a V. So the advantage of this V is that you are able to make the trench very comfortably. And you should deliver, there should be no air bubble formation when you are delivering the energy over there. If you are giving too much of energy, there will be air bubble formation. There should be no pushing of the nucleus. That means deliver the energy as it is adequate for cutting the nucleus. Neither too much nor too less that you push it. And in a harder cataract, it should not close more than one-fourth of the tip of the phaco. Don't try to bury too much and try to cut too much. And see, after we have rotated it, now because of this V shape, if you see the phaco tip is like V because of the sleeve now. So if you make a straight, simple trench in the center, the sleeve does not get accommodated into this trench. So when you are trying to trench it, the sleeve will keep on obstructing, will not allow you to go into the depth. But once you have made a V-shaped trench, then this sleeve can get accommodated very comfortably into this trench and you can go deeper. So initially when we make a trench, now you can have a X-shaped trench over here. One V on this side, one V on this side, or a Y-shaped trench, you can go straight away center because this part now can be accommodated very well. And once you have gone into the periphery, you have got to make an effort to make sure that the central part is the deepest part of your trench. Now if you see this, when it comes out, you can see a little bit of glow coming from this area. You can see this is a little becoming blackish. So the trench has reached to the depth in this part, so you don't have to go over here. Now after this, you will see my strokes are becoming shorter. I'm not going up to the periphery. So I'm just finishing before going to the periphery. I'm just trying to finish it over here and make sure suddenly, because the luckily for us, the hardest part is not the posterior most. It is little forward, nearly at the junction of 3/5 and 2/5 of the nucleus. So suddenly when you are using the same energy, once the hardest part is gone, suddenly you will see that suddenly you will see tongue-shaped tissue disappearing over there, because that is a little softer than the hardest part. And once you see that, that means trench is deep enough. And when you put these instruments, one of the instruments have to have into the full depth like this. If they are superficial, you will keep on pushing them sideways without actually breaking. So ensure that one of the instruments goes to the full depth, and we turn whenever there is a catheter is hard, you can go into the FACO aspiration mode or to 400, 500 vacuum and do the trenching like this. If you keep, and whenever you are splitting the nucleus or chopping the nucleus, it is very important to understand, if you want to split a rubber band over here, if your hands are too far apart, you will need more space to break them before it reaches the break point. But if your hands are closer, they will split with a very little space. So all your instruments, whatever you are using for splitting, have to be closer to the area you want to split. If you keep them too far away, they will not split. Like in this, if I put my chopper over here and a FACO probe over here, not into full depth, so when I'm trying to split this area, it will not split. It will, you will just bend it like this into the periphery. But if you put into the depth and try to lift at the depth and trying to lift the periphery, it will split very easily. So you have got to be closer to the area you want to split. So when we come to the chopping, we need to create a vacuum seal, central chop, peripheral chop, and a modified peripheral chop. So vacuum seal is that when we first give a burst of energy to bury a tip half a millimeter, 1 millimeter inside the nucleus, now the FACO energy is stopped. Only the vacuum part is working and it holds it. So if you keep on giving the energy, it will keep on loosening it and you will not able to grip it. So bury into the densest part of the nucleus, not too superficial, not too deep, maybe at this junction of the anterior two-third and a posterior one-third, where you should bury your FACO tip. And once you have created a vacuum seal, then you can go into the chopping, which may be a central chop. That means you bury close to this tip without negotiating the excess margin, just bury like this and separate sideways. Or it could be a peripheral chop. This was very cumbersome, because before creating a vacuum seal, we used to put a chopper underneath the excess margin, which was horizontal. Then we will create a vacuum seal. Then we'll turn the chopper vertical and pull it towards this tip. And once it comes closer to the tip, we'll pull it sideways to separate it. So this was a little cumbersome to keep the chopper at the delineation line, create a vacuum seal, and then pull it. But the advantage of this chopping technique was it is a very strong chop. Even the hardest piece, because you're starting from the periphery, can cut through and through. While central, you are trying to push it downwards, and there's little chances of tumbling. So both the techniques are good. I'll be showing you now the video of this. This is a central chop where you are putting the chopper into it. Now I've created a vacuum seal, and just close to the tip, this is the side, if it should not cross the tip on this side, otherwise you lose the vacuum seal. If it is too far away from the tip, it will tumble. So it has to be adjacent, just adjacent to the tip in front of it, bury it, and then separate it sideways. So this is where you get the maximum purchase and the easiest way to chop it. Now see again. Again, nudge it. I just nudge it, given energy. Now no more energy. It holds over there, lollipops it, holds it there. Vacuum seal has been created. It has been lollipop. It has been held over there. Then you see the chopper keeps on getting buried. And once it comes over here, I'm trying to separate it, reposition your chopper, reposition your chopper, reposition your chopper where you want to split the fibers. So don't keep on pulling from here itself into the periphery, because your fibers are here, you got to put your chopper there. So always go closer to the fibers you want to split. You won't cause any stress onto the genules, there will be no chance of tumbling and pushing the posterior capsule behind. So this way you can keep on splitting, position it 2-3 times. Even in a very hard and a lengthy cataract, you might have to position your FACO tip also if it has been too superficially placed. Now I'll show you another very good technique, what I call as a modified peripheral chop. Instead of negotiating my chopper underneath the rectus margin, I pull the periphery of the nucleus out of the rectus margin so that I can start the chopping from the periphery without having to have a cumbersome procedure of negotiating my chopper underneath the rectus. So it becomes very comfortable in the second half of a large nucleus, because now there is enough of a space. Now vacuum seal created. Pull the periphery out of the rectus margin. Go to the periphery and chop it. So it can chop in a one go far more easily as compared to the central chop. So in a modified peripheral chop, instead of negotiating my chopper inside, I pull the periphery of the nucleus outside the rectus margin and then chop it. So this splits far more easily. And we need to keep on making sure that your phaco pieces are away. And if the cataract is very hard, keep on injecting the viscoelastic in between and keep on crushing the nucleus with your phaco probe. If you keep on making them smaller and smaller, their followability keeps on increasing. It will follow it far more easily into the phaco tip. If they are too big, they don't follow. Now again, I pulled it out of the rectus margin, gone to the periphery, separated as a rotating. I'm rotating it, I'm not pushing it into the periphery. Just a rotation so that I use the space in the eye absolutely perfectly over there without causing any stress to the capsule or the junules. And while doing phaco aspiration, just crush the nucleus over there on top of it. Just keep on breaking it over there. And take your time. This is the most crucial step. 1 or 2 minutes is really not going to make much of a difference into the whole of the surgery. But if you take 1 or 2 minutes extra, keep on crushing, then the surgery becomes far more safer and better. And be careful when you are going to move the last piece, because that is the time when there is nothing in the capsule of fornices, whole of the nucleus has been removed. Now the posterior capsule has got a more tendency to come forward. As long as some of the nucleus is there into the capsule of fornices, it won't come forward. So the direct chop, I do not personally prefer it. I usually prefer the stop and chop technique. And these all have been described, AIOS CMEC is what I have written in this, a guide to phacoemulsification. Most of you must have received. If you want, still go and visit www.ios.org where you can find the CME series. And if you want a hard copy, you can email me, SMS me, I'll send you over there. So thank you very much for being here.